More recently, that we've been a memory in the harassment of oil surveys. Yeah, the Scarborough Shoal stand of the People's Liberation Army conducting military training exercises close to Malaysia's James Shoal, and so on. So since 2007, for 8 or 9 years, a series of measures taken by China. There's also the growing perception that China's economic and strategic policies in the region are becoming more and more intertwined. So for instance, this is just a graph, I'm sure you can see it from there, but an infographic prepared by some Indian media outfit, just demonstrating that what China has been doing is establishing land roads, the so-called One Belt, One Road initiative of China to connect economies, especially to infrastructure, ports, roads, and so on, of China with those of Central Asia, South Asia, all the way to Europe. And then that's the One Belt, then the One Road, the 21st century maritime Silk Road, which tries to connect, again, the Chinese economy with Southeast Asian countries, Indian Ocean countries, all the way to Africa. So more, well, some are looking at this rather than as economic initiatives, economic diplomacy, or legitimate efforts to expand trade and economic relations. Some are seeing this as part of some strategic game plan. Now, there are others like the Asian Infrastructure Investment Plan. So similarly, China has a lot of cash, so it has established this plan to, from its perspective, to help developing countries set up the much-needed infrastructure. Some of you may know that the Philippines was supposed to be a founding member of this AIIB. Of China, but we were among the originals who signified interest. In the end, we signed up only on the last day of December, on the very last day, because of some pressures from the US and from Japan also, you know, not to sign up. That's China's game. Do you really want to be part of that? It's going to compete with the ADB, post Panamangan Manila ng ADB. It's going to compete with the World Bank. The kinds of governance mechanisms for AIIB may not be as, you know, transparent or as accountable as those that have been developed already. So those, there were political pressures not to join the AIIB, citing these kinds of governance concerns. But at the back, also strategic security concerns, that this kind of instrument will allow China also to grow its influence among developing countries. Now, what about the U.S.? What has it been up to? Well, we mentioned the rebalance of the pivot policy. So also quite actively. In the past, this part of the world distracted the United States. But coming upon the realization that at the end of the day, China was the more strategic cause for concern for the United States. They have been, the pivot policy, the rebalance policy, is supposed to commit some of the troops, the aircraft carriers, and so on, away from the Middle East and into East Asia. So yun ang pivot done. The target is that 60% of America's military strength basically will have to be based in East Asia, addressing the scenario of China and possible attempt by China to ease the U.S. out. Basically, that is the fear of the United States. Well, I mentioned the Pacific Command, the 7th Fleet, which is the really the most powerful tool of U.S. foreign policy. It's a military. It's a navy that can go at fairly short notice to where it is needed. Now, that is what the U.S. has and what others don't have. And therefore, that is the one of the, I guess, remaining strengths of the United States. It is something that China wants, but currently does not have. U.S. also has its economic rebalance policy for the Trans-Pacific Partnership. So hindi na lang, well, China has its One Belt, One Road, and AIIB. U.S. has indicated that its pivot to Asia is not only military, it is also economic. And what is the Trans-Pacific Partnership? 12 countries, it's much bigger than the South China Sea. Ito naman South China Sea. But this is the global game that the U.S. wants to play. Ganun din yung sa China, yung AIIB. Okay, bring you back to that. The members of the AIIB, intended members, are also spread out all over the world, but many, of course, closer to where China is. So these are two big powers locked in strategic competition, no longer just in East Asia, but on a global level. Now, what does this have to do with the South China Sea, the West Philippine Sea? This is the major arena for this competition to take place, because this is the area where China's own military expansion will have some impact and some influence in the South China Sea. The worst case scenario is John Mersheimer, the poster boy, I think, for offensive realism. So he is the most pessimistic American scholar when it comes to predicting the future of this relationship between the great powers. He says, my argument in a nutshell is that if China continues to grow economically, it will attempt to dominate Asia the way the United States dominates the Western Hemisphere. The U.S. will go to enormous lengths to prevent China from achieving regional hegemony. Most of Beijing's neighbors, including India, Japan, Singapore, South Korea, Russia, and Vietnam, note, he did not mention the Philippines. Most of his neighbors will join with the U.S. to contain China's power. And the result will be an intense security competition with considerable potential for war. This is what we need to avoid. This is the worst case scenario that we don't want ourselves to fall into. But some we do. John Mearsheimer, that this is inevitable. Okay. These are just questions, no? With respect to the U.S.-China competition for spheres of influence. Will China become a maritime power? Can U.S. remain the preponderant power? I'll just gloss over this because we don't have time to answer. Now let me say a few words about this. The U.S.-China competition, in part, is also about trying to influence the shaping of a new regional order and security architecture. Right now, there's very little that can be called, that can be said to be a regional order. In East Asia, we have a system of U.S. alliances. We have U.S. Japan, U.S. Australia, and U.S. Philippines. And so these alliances are assumed to help keep order, stability, and peace, and prevent conflict in this in our part of the world. Other than that, we have groups like ASEAN with all of its multilateral mechanisms, ASEAN Regional Forum, ASEAN Plus 3, East Asia Summit, and so on, that also try to contribute, encouraging cooperation among states. and so on. But at the end of the day, what do we see as the emerging regional order, even in East Asia alone, from Japan to say Singapore, Malaysia, that spread. Now, what will be the global order that we foresee? So, well, international relations scholars, they look at a number of scenarios. What is hegemony? Hegemony, there has to be a number one country. Right now, it's the U.S., but the U.S. is in decline. Economically, financially, political dysfunctionalism also inside the U.S. So can it still be a hegemon? Probably a hegemon with China. So one scenario. Condominium. U.S. and China ruling the world together, so to speak. Is that going to happen? From today's vantage point, maybe not. Concert of powers, big powers, not just U.S., China, but India, Japan, maybe Germany, and so on, cooperating to set the rules for the rest of the world. Because, you know, we think, you know, we have a pretty stable world, but there's really quite little holding it up. So this question still remains. Alliances, cooperative security, multilateralism, etc. So who will, basically, who will set the rules, or who will determine what kind of order we will have in the future? Great powers want to have a bigger say in answering that question. So we'll be seeing it for happening for the US and China. Now, my main points here, really, is I said that U.S., China, and the Philippines all face quandaries. But what among the quandaries of the U.S. is it has to defend its privacy at a time when it has less resources for doing so. If U.S. wants to continue to be number one, that will need money, that will need resources, and it doesn't have those resources. I already mentioned the economic situation in the U.S. is not good. Will technological fixes save the day? In history, during times of crisis, the U.S. embarks on major technological breakthroughs. And that is expected to sort of jumpstart the U.S. economy all over again. Unfortunately, many of those technologies are war technologies, military technologies. So if the U.S. were to resort to this again, that's not necessarily welcome outcome. Who can save the day for the U.S.? Will Chinese assertiveness save the day? Some are in fact arguing that yes, even if the U.S. is weak now and has much less political influence, the mere fact that China is being so assertive and so obnoxious to its neighbors is already helping justify the need for the U.S. So countries, especially in our region, around the South China Sea, want the U.S. to stay. Why? The biggest reason now, points to China. So if China really was competing with the United States for influence, you might say that it's doing all the wrong things. Because what China has been doing has been justifying continued U.S. presence and in fact even increasing U.S. influence among the countries of the region. So it's being counterproductive. Another quandary of the U.S. is how to manage its alliances. Alliance credibility versus alliance entanglement. If you ask yourself, why is the U.S. supporting the Philippines in the West Philippine Sea, okay, with respect to our claims? It's because it has to maintain the credibility of its alliances. It has to convince other countries that if you are an ally of the U.S., U.S. will be there to help you. If it fails to convince the Philippines, it will fail to convince Japan and South Korea and Australia and others down the line. Which means if the U.S. does not, if the allies of the U.S. don't believe that the U.S. is there for them, then it's just a matter of time before the alliance system itself breaks apart. It's useless. It's a useless alliance. So U.S. has to be there to show that the alliance system works. Also, especially because it doesn't have the money anymore. So it has to work through its allies. So who will end up spending for U.S. presence and for world development? Japan has been doing it, Korea has been doing it, Philippines, we have already said yes in the Fed, we will do it. In EDCA. So we will end up supporting U.S. So on the one hand, U.S. Thinks it has to show support for its allies to shore up its own power and influence. On the other hand, it's afraid of getting entangled in the quarrels and the disputes of its allies, its smaller and weaker allies. And it is a partner of Philippines. It always insists that it is neutral with respect to the sovereignty disputes, but it is there to provide assistance to its allies in other ways. So U.S. also fears entanglement. It's the credibility of the alliance has to be shored up because less and it's, the credibility has declined significantly. So also, U.S. is afraid that the Philippines will try to get it involved in our quarrels with China. It doesn't want that. So you would think that U.S. wants that. And some of us, ordinary people, when they see that the U.S. is trying to be active in the South China Sea and China has to step back, natutuwa sila. Well, in fact, the U.S. does not want to be entangled. It's always, it's still playing that balance to show that it is powerful, to shore up the credibility of its alliance, but not to get entangled. Now that may be a difficult balance to keep in the future, especially if China deliberately provokes or challenges U.S. to show how strong it is, to show how strong the alliance is. Okay, another quandary for the U.S. is China is not an enemy of the U.S. It is also not a friend. Depending on the circumstances, depending on the interests that we are talking about, it can be both, it can be neither. So sabi nila, frenemy. What is China to the U.S.? It's a frenemy. Sometimes friend, sometimes enemy, sometimes neither. Therefore, to expect that the U.S. will embark on a long-term program to push back China's economic gains or attempts to influence the region, we'll have to, you know, start, I guess, the test of history, the test of time, kung ganun talaga. Because right now, U.S. does not consider China an enemy. It is reacting to scenarios, it is reacting to specific actions being American by China, but it's not saying that we will contain China. We will stop China from rising because of the interdependence factor that we're talking about. Masyado nang intertwined interests nila economically. So that will be a problem for the U.S. There will always be elements of competition and cooperation in its relationship with China, and the emphasis will change depending again on the circumstances. So can we expect policy consistency on the part of the U.S.? I don't think we can. Another quandary of the U.S. is it's not even a signatory of the UN Convention on Democracy. It's not. And yet it is the one calling, you know, taking China to task, asking China to abide by the rule of law. It's not that U.S. is wrong in saying that. It's just that it has little credibility because its own government has not signed or ratified this convention that all of us, but most especially the Philippines, has been invoking. So our attitude is a solution, rely on rule of law, rule clause. U.S. is mouthing it, but it's not walking the talk. Not yet. Not yet. May mga internal issues pa sila. But that puts the U.S. at a disadvantage. And it talks about what to do with, in the South China Sea. But China also has its own quandaries. May problema rin ng China. One is it's a dissatisfied power, but it's not ready to confront the U.S. It's not ready because it knows it is not capable enough militarily. Maybe if it were, then it would try to do that more, to confront the U.S. more. So there are material limits to China's military adventures. Another is China has few real allies. U.S. somehow, historically, and for reasons of ideology and so on, has allies, but China doesn't. The only formal alliance, China even denies it's an alliance, that they have is with North Korea. Pakistan is very close to China in its foreign policy, so virtual, virtually allied. I think they have already cemented this through agreements. But when you look at the whole world, there are few countries that would stand by China if it were to decide to confront the United States. So therefore, that limits China's actions. Right now, the government under Xi Jinping has been pursuing what we call the China dream. That finally, after a long period of reform, it is already imaginable for the Chinese people to enjoy a certain level of prosperity and progress. This will also translate into more international leadership for the Chinese government, moving in that direction. But unfortunately for them, they're facing economic slowdown right now. I guess the experts are still divided on how far or how deep the economic slowdown will be. Some say this is the start of a long process. China will have to do much to try to recover. Some are saying this is just a temporary blip. But the longer the economic problems of China continue, then the more difficult to sustain these aspirations of the China dream. Kasi yung government nila, pinapangako na sa mga tao. It's within our grasp. So the expectations are quite high, but now there are economic constraints. Another problem for China is that its regional policy is really full of contradictions. It talks about win-win situation, cooperation, good neighbor policy. It talks about, you know, unifying or linking up through the Maritime Silk Road, the One Belt, One Road. So a lot of good initiatives are on the table. AIIB offering, you know, support, financial support for infrastructure programs, developing countries.